حبيب الله رسول الله حبيب الله
Allah our God is the greatest the one and only glory to him he wanted humans to be the best and give his best religion to them Allah our God is the greatest the one and only glory to him Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Praise be to Allah alone. We all praise Him and we seek His help. Whomsoever Allah guides is the truly guided one, and whomsoever Allah leaves astray, no one can show Him guidance. May the best peace and blessings be upon Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Dear viewers everywhere, welcome to the 38th episode of Guardians of the Pious. Today, inshallah, we shall continue by his leave explaining the book of watchfulness or Babul Muraqabah. And we will begin with explaining the second hadith, which happens to be the 61st hadith of Riyadh al-Salihin. The narrator of this hadith is a great companion, Abu Dharr al-Ghifari, may Allah be pleased with him, whose name is Abu Dharr Jundub ibn Junada. عن أبي ذر جندب ابن جنادة وأبي عبد الرحمن معاذ بن جبل رضي الله عنهما عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال اتق الله حيثما كنت وأتبع السيئة الحسنة تمحها وخالق الناس بخلق حسن رواه الترمذي وقال حديث حسن In a very, very comprehensive hadith which is narrated by Abu Dharr al-Ghifari and Mu'ad ibn Jabal, may Allah be pleased with them, that they both narrated that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, Fear Allah and keep your duty to Him wheresoever you are, and follow the evil deed with one which is good, it shall erase it, and be well-mannered in your relationship with people. Three beautiful advices comprehend our relationship with Allah and with the rest of the creation. So with Allah and with the creation. The first and the second pertaining to our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how it should be. And the second is a reflection of our relationship with Allah upon our relationship with people. All people, without specification, Muslims, non-Muslims, and so on. The first advice, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Fear Allah so that you keep your duty to Him by doing what He commanded and abstaining from what He prohibited all the time. Wheresoever you may be at, wherever you are, in public, in private, in a Muslim society, surrounded by righteous people, or a non-Muslim community and surrounded by wicked people, whether somebody is watching you or not. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam means to raise the awareness of Allah's presence all the time in our minds so that you don't feel alone. وَهُوَ مَعَكُمْ أَيْنَمَا كُنْتُمْ And Allah is with you wheresoever you are. This is the meaning of اتق الله حيثما كنت. So don't feel into the habit of being good and righteous sometimes, specifically whenever you are being watched by people or surrounded by a good company or those whom you feel ashamed of to do something bad. Then being bad some other times when you are alone or by yourself in private or with a bad or an evil peer. Why? Because this watchfulness and supervision is from Allah, is not from people. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to one of the companions in an advice that you should feel shy before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as you feel shy whenever you are with a couple or a few of the good people of your community. Yani whenever you are around the sheikh, the imam, or the righteous people of your family members, You try not to watch what Allah forbidden, and you're afraid to smoke in front of them. And you know something very interesting, that the sisters who do not normally wear hijab, when they attend a party, and whenever the sheikh is speaking, they turn the flip-flop hijab on, so they cover their hair. And soon after the sheikh departs, it glides down. Like the hijab was only for the sheikh. He was the only person who was not supposed to see your hair, was not supposed to see your beauty. This is false. This is entirely false. Whenever you decide to wear the hijab, this is because Allah commanded you to put the hijab on. Whenever you are not drinking, you're not smoking, you are not watching what Allah has forbidden, this is because Allah has commanded so, not because who is watching you otherwise. And that is the proper haya or shyness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. By safeguarding the head and what it contains, the sight, the hearing, the tongue, and safeguarding the stomach and what it contains, and by constantly remembering death and the shortness of this life, and accordingly preparing for the hereafter. So raising the awareness of Allah's presence at all times is very important, and that is the first advice, which is اتَّقِ اللَّهَ حَيْثُ مَا كُنْت. Some people in their countries, they pray on time because they are obliged to, not because they are obliged by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but because they have to. If they don't pray in the community, it's a big shame. They will be kicked out, they will be grounded, whatever. If they have a chance to travel to study abroad, then they become on their own. And that's a disaster. This is a sign of hypocrisy. But اتَّقِ اللَّهَ حَيْثُمَا كُنْت. I visited a friend of mine whose son was in high school. So he gave him a room to study by himself. And I looked around in this room. There were no pictures, no images, nothing. But a copy paper, which he hung against the wall. He glued it against the wall. And he wrote on that paper, لَسْتَ وَحْدَكْ اللَّهُ مَعَكْ. I was taken by this phrase, and I can never forget it. It's been years now, but I still remember it as I could see right now. لَسْتَ وَحْدَكْ اللَّهُ مَعَكْ. It is not a hadith, but this is a conclusion of all what we studied in the watchfulness. He said to his son, you're not alone. So when we close the door and leave you to study, you're not alone. Allah is with you, so behave accordingly. It is not just a word, brothers and sisters. It's a matter of bringing up yourself, your children, and your family members according to this concept. If you do so, it will be very hard to deviate. It will always keep you steadfast on the straight path. The second advice is, since we are human beings, it is impossible for one to be always good and to stay on the straight path without slipping a little right, a little left, then trying to resume back on the straight path, and so on. Because Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, كل بني آدم خطأ. All the children of Adam do commit sins. وخير الخطائين التوابون. And the best of those who sin are those who frequently repent. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Al-Baqarah, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ التَّوَّابِينَ وَيُحِبُّ الْمُتَطَهِرِينَ. Allah loves those who frequently repent and frequently purify themselves. Whenever the servant of Allah commits a sin, it leaves a black dot. If he rushes to repent, he will erase it. If he doesn't, and then he does another sin, it would leave a black mark. Then another one, and another one, and another one, until the heart will be hardened like in a shell, and the heart will be blackened and darkened. And this is a situation which is recognized or diagnosed as al-qalb al-mayyit, or the dead heart. In order to avoid being degraded to this very awful stage, and Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the second advice, follow the evil deed with one which is good, it shall erase it. We studied in the conditions of the sincere repentance that the person should recognize and acknowledge his sin, regret and promise not to do it again, and then fourthly, to follow the sin with a good deed in order to erase it. And Ali ibn Abi Talib and Abu Bakr al-Siddiq narrated a hadith in which the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, whoever after sinning makes a perfect wudu and offers two rak'ahs with the intention of seeking forgiveness for the sin which he has committed, it will be as if it did not take place. So this hadith comes in line with the hadith which we studied before in the chapter of Tawbah, repentance and seeking forgiveness. But it specifies a very important fact, which is that following the bad deed with one which is good, it shall erase it. And that was also known in the hadith in which the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, As-salawatu al-khams, wal-jumu'atu ila al-jumu'ati, kaffaratu lima baynahuma, majtunibatil kabair. Offering the 5 daily prayers, and Friday till next Friday prayer, of course, these are all expiation for the sins which are committed in between, so long as you avoid the major sins. إِن تَجْتَنِبُوا كَبَائِرَ مَا تُنْهَوْنَ عَنْهُ نُكَفِّرْ عَنْكُمْ سَيِّئَاتِكُمْ وَنُدْخِلْكُمْ مُدْخَلًا كَرِيمًا. Allah the Almighty says in Surah An-Nisa, so long as you avoid كَبَائِرَ مَا تُنْهَوْنَ عَنْهُ, the major sins. Lying is a major sin. Adultery is a major sin. Drinking is a major sin. Eating riba or usury, these are all major sins. So when you avoid these major sins, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promises that نُكَفِّرْ عَنْكُمْ سَيِّئَاتِكُمْ, we will expiate your sins from you. Furthermore, وَنُدْخِلْكُمْ مُدْخَلًا كَرِيمًا, and we will admit you into a noble entry. That is Al-Jannah, of course. In Surah Al-Furqan, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala counted some of the major sins, وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَدْعُونَ مَعَ اللَّهِ إِلَهًا آخَرَ وَلَا يَقْتُلُونَ النَّفْسَ الَّتِي حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ إِلَّا بِالْحَقِّ وَلَا يَزْنُونَ وَمَنْ يَفْعَلْ ذَلِكَ يَلْقَ أَثَامًا يُضَاعَفْ لَهُ الْعَذَابُ وَيَخْلُدْ فِيهِ مُهَانًا يُضَاعَفْ لَهُ الْعَذَابُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ وَيَخْلُدْ فِيهِ مُهَانًا. Wait a minute, before we go to the next ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala counted some major sins, shirk, killing, and committing adultery. And he threatened, whosoever will indulge into any of these activities will receive double the torment on the day of judgment, and he will reside therein eternally. Obviously, this is pertaining the sins, like shirk, for innocence. Otherwise, a believer does not remain eternally in hell. If he had his bad deeds outweighed his good deeds, he will be purified for a while. But لا يخلد في النار من كان في قلبه مثقال ذرة من إيمان. One who has an atom weight of faith would not remain eternally in hell. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said afterward, إلا, after he threatened a severe torment on the day of judgment, said, except من تاب وآمن وعمل عملا صالحا فأولئك يبدل الله سيئاتهم حسنات. For those who repent, they believe, and they do what? A good deed. They follow the evil deed with one which is good. As in the hadith says, it shall erase it. And the ayah here says in Surah Al-Furqan, such people, Allah will convert their sins into good deeds. وَكَانَ اللَّهُ غَفُورًا رَحِيمًا. So they have committed 10,000 sins, but now they repented. They followed their evil deeds with good deeds after repentance. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will turn their bad deeds, the number of their bad deeds, into a similar number of hasanat. فَأُولَٰئِكَ يُبَدِّلُ اللَّهُ سَيِّئَاتِهِمْ حَسَنَاتِ. Why? Because وَكَانَ اللَّهُ غَفُورًا رَحِيمًا. Allah is ever all forgiving and most merciful. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in ayah number 31 of Surah An-Nur, وَتُوبُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا أَيُّهَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ. And this ayah came after Allah mentioned what is prohibited with regards to women and looking at women and the command of lowering the gaze and the command of hijab for women and so on. Then, because this is something that frequently happens nowadays, if you happen to go to the mall for half hour, you return with tons of bad deeds. Selling, buying, trading. Business now is pretty much contaminated with usury, contaminated with lying, deceiving. So one has to repent, and repent a lot. Repent frequently. Even if he does not recall a specific sin, guess what? If one were to hold himself accountable from morning till evening, but honestly, and writes down everything that he does, he will not be able to keep record. And because of that, we need to frequently repent and do good deeds as much as we can in order to erase and take care of the bad ones. وَأَتْبِعِ السَّيِّئَةَ الْحَسَنَةَ تَمْحُهَا وَخَالِقِ النَّاسَ بِخُلُقٍ حَسَنٍ. Also, performing umrah after another umrah is an expiation for the sins which were committed in between Ramadan till next Ramadan, fasting and performing Hajj. Insha'Allah, in a few days, people are going to perform Hajj. May Allah grant us all the reward of Hajj for just intending to go, even if you can go. And may Allah make it easy for those who are planning to perform Hajj this year to perform an accepted and a proper Hajj. And those who were not able to, may Allah grant them the same reward of performing Hajj, inshallah, and make it easy for them in the near future to get to perform this great act of worship. الحج المبرور ليس له جزاء إلا الجنة. It expiates all the previous sins. The minor, of course, what about the major? You're required to make an independent, sincere repentance from those sins. You've been working in a bank, conventional bank, facilitating the riba dealing. Don't you ever tell me, but Sheikh so-and-so or the Grand Mufti of this, whatever, said it is halal. That is not an excuse. That will never justify your misdoing. Haram is haram. Al-halal ubayyin, wal-halal ubayyin. Al-halal ubayyin, wal-haram ubayyin. It's very clear what is riba and what is haram and what is halal. You can't play games when it comes to dealing with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nor can you just blame it on somebody else. Yes, he is blameworthy, but you're not going to be excused simply because you took the opinion of somebody while you know for sure it's invalid. Okay. So you need to repent from the major sins. In addition to following the minor sins with good deeds, that will erase it as well, inshallah, azza wa jal. Now with the third advice, which, as I said, dealing with al-makhluq. The first and the second advices were dealing with al-khaliq, with the creator, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Can you imagine somebody who is so good in his relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? He prays on time, he fasts, not just Ramadan, but extra voluntary fasting, and he's very charitable. But he would have bad manners? Of course not. Of course not. That's why النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم said, إنما بعثت لأتمم مكارم الأخلاق. I have been sent exclusively to perfect good manners. You find the various commands of Tawheed in the Quran followed by the commands of good akhlaq. وَاعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ وَلَا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا وَبِذِي الْقُرْبَى وَالْيَتَامَى وَالْمَسَاكِينِ وَالْجَارِ ذِي الْقُرْبَى وَالْجَارِ الْجُنُبِ وَالصَّاحِبِ بِالْجَبِّ وَابْنِ السَّبِيلِ وَمَا مَلَكَتْ أَيْمَانُكُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُحِبُّ مَنْ كَانَ مُخْتَالًا فَخُورًا. Bunch of good commands are commanded in the same ayah with at-tawheed. Being good to your parents, to your relatives, to your neighbors, to the poor, to the miskin, to the orphans, then followed by what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala dislikes. He dislikes those who are arrogant, ones boastful, those who are miser, al-akhlaq. And a person who is well-mannered, this is a great sign that this person is a true believer. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم سيد إن الرجل ليدرك بحسن خلقه درجة الصائم الذي لا يفطر والقائم الذي لا يفطر. A person may attain the level of a person who's fasting on every single day, non-stop, and praying on every single night, non-stop. He can achieve this level without doing so. How? بِحُسْنِ خُلُقِهِ By simply being well-mannered, having good manners. والنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم said in the hadith, أَكْمَلُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِيمَانًا أَحْسَنُهُمْ خُلُقًا The most perfect of faith or in faith of the believers are those who have the best akhlaq. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us amongst them. The third hadith, which happens to be the 62nd hadith in the collection of this beautiful book of Al-Imam al-Nawawi, Riyad al-Salihin. The hadith is narrated by Abdullah ibn Abbas, radiyallahu anhuma, قال, كنت خلف النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يوما فقال يا غلام إني أعلمك كلمات احفظ الله يحفظك احفظ الله تجده تجاهك إذا سألت فاسأل الله وإذا استعنت فاستعن بالله واعلم أن الأمة لو اجتمعت على أن ينفعوك بشيء لم ينفعوك إلا بشيء قد كتبه الله لك وإن اجتمعوا على أن يضروك بشيء لم يضروك إلا بشيء قد كتبه الله عليك رفعت الأقلام وجفت الصحف الحديث رواه الترمذي وقال حديث حسن صحيح وفي رواية غير الترمذي احفظ الله تجده أمامك تعرف إلى الله في الرخاء يعرفك في الشدة واعلم أن ما أخطأك لم يكن ليصيبك وما أصابك لم يكن ليخطئك واعلم أن النصر مع الصبر وأن الفرج مع الكرب وأن مع العسر يسرا عبد الله بن عباس may Allah be pleased with him and his father was a teenager when the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم died he was approximately 15 years old So that must have happened a couple years before that. At this age, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam seizes the opportunity of having Abdullah ibn Abbas, his cousin, riding behind him on the same mount, and he started teaching him very important lessons of the aqidah and al-muraqabah, or the watchfulness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Abdullah ibn Abbas narrated that. He said, One day I was riding behind the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he said, Ya Ghulam, I will instruct you in some matters. I'm going to teach you a few words. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Be mindful of Allah's presence. He will preserve you. Safeguard His rights. He will be ever with you. If you ask, you should only ask of Him alone. And if you need assistance, then supplicate to Allah alone for help. And remember that if all people gather to benefit you, they will never be able to benefit you except that which Allah had ordained for you. And if all of them gather to harm you or to do harm to you, they will not be able to afflict you with anything rather or other than that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had preordained against you. The pins had been lifted. The pins which record our destiny and preordainment had been lifted and the ink had dried up. In another narration other than the collection of At-Tirmidhi, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to Abdullah ibn Abbas, احفظ الله تجده أمامك. Which means be mindful of Allah, which means safeguard the commandments of Allah, you will find Allah always before you. Remember Him in prosperity and He will remember you in adversity. Be sure that what you miss was not to hit you and that which hit you was never going to miss you. Remember that The help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is obtained with patience, and relief emerges after distress. Prosperity follows adversity, and hardship is followed by ease. This is a wonderful hadith, which of course we need some time to learn and explain its meaning, and that should be after this short break, inshallah. So stay tuned. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome back. We mentioned before the break the hadith of احفظ الله يحفظك. And I also pointed out that the narrator of this hadith was a teenager, Abdullah ibn Abbas, at this time. And obviously, Abdullah ibn Abbas later on has become one of the greatest scholars of this ummah. When he was young, Umar ibn Khattab radiyallahu anhu used to invite him to the meeting of the chiefs of the ummah, to the great companions. He would sit with them in their gathering, not because of his relationship to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, rather because of his quality of knowledge. And that's why when some of the companions objected, "Why do you let this kid sit with us?" He wanted to prove to them that he is more than eligible to attend. So what happened is one day, Umar ibn Khattab recited Surah Al-Nasr, which reads as, إِذَا جَاءَ نَصُ اللَّهِ وَالْفَتْحِ وَرَأَيْتَ النَّاسَ يَدْخُلُونَ فِي دِينِ اللَّهِ أَفْوَاجًا فَسَبِّحْ بِحَمْدَ رَبِّكَ وَاسْتَغْفِرْهِ إِنَّهُ كَانَ تَوَّابًا. Then he asked the companions, "What do you say of the tafsir of this surah?" So their words were around that, the literal meaning, that whenever the victory of Allah comes, that you should give tasbih and be grateful to Allah and seek His forgiveness, because He is the one who accepts the repentance, and so on. That is the obvious meaning. Then he turned to Abdullah ibn Abbas and said, "Ya ibn Abbas, what do you think of the surah?" He said, "Allahu yan'i nabiyya." So he was very impressed with this understanding, and he proved the point why he allowed and invited Abdullah ibn Abbas, this teenager or this young man, to attend with the chiefs of this ummah and the elders of the companions, because of the quality of knowledge. And the word Allahu yan'i nabiyya means that, "Ya Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, once the Mecca has been conquered and you have seen people entering into the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in groups, so that's a sign of the nearness of your term. That's it. So prepare yourself for departure. Allah is announcing the death of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to his Prophet. So prepare for his meeting by concluding your deeds by tasbih wa istighfar, because Allah is the one who accepts the tawbah. Tawwaba." So Abdullah ibn Abbas did not just become a scholar out of the blue without making an effort. No. And that's why we need to invest in our children. While we're sitting and eating, we discuss some important issue or some serious matter in the deen, or say a hadith, even if they do not understand a word of the hadith. You say the hadith frequently, then you explain the meaning of the hadith once and twice and several times. Repeat Surah Al-Kahf, which you guys recite on every Friday. Every week you take a story of the surah and explain, because these stories were not for mere entertainment. Rather, لَقَدْ كَانَ فِي قَصَصِهِمْ عِبْرَةٌ لِأُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ. These stories are for an admonition for men of understanding. So share with them an ayah, a hadith, an incident of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the command of eating or drinking, using the right hand. A lot of people belittle this sunnah and think, you know, it doesn't really matter. And they make fun of that and said, well, back then they did not have spoons nor forks. And they belittle this sunnah, and this is not right. If you truly love Allah and His Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you will find yourself talking about Him and about them all the time, especially with your children, and sharing with them these important thoughts and teachings. This hadith, many adults do not understand it. While the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sharing this hadith with a teenager, a kid who is approximately 13, 14 years old. احفظ الله يحفظك. Maybe even under the age of puberty, but he's preparing him. And this kid memorizes the hadith and he teaches the whole ummah forever until the day of judgment about this incident, and will benefit a great deal from this hadith. احفظ, the word احفظ is a command verb, which literally means safeguard or protect. It's very obvious when you say protect your wallet, protect your belonging, fine. But when you say احفظ الله, what does it mean? How could you protect Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? We'll hear it is not literal though, because the word احفظ has a broader meaning than just safeguard or protect. Rather here it will be mindful of Allah, protect and safeguard the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not in need for anyone's protection or help. Rather, he said in Surah Muhammad, in Surah Fatir, he said, وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ لِيُعْجِزَهُ مِنْ شَيْءٍ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَلَا فِي الْأَرْضِ. There is nothing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cannot do or overcome Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or His command in the heavens or on earth. Allah is all powerful. إِنَّمَا أَمْرُهُ إِذَا رَادَ شَيْءٍ أَنْ يَقُولَ لَهُ كُنْ فَيَكُونَ. But he said in Surah Muhammad, إِنْ تَنْصُرُ اللَّهَ يَنْصُرْكُمْ وَيُثَبِّتْ أَقْدَامَكُمْ. Look at this equation. If you give nusra to Allah, Allah will give you nusra, يعني will give you victory. So here, if you safeguard Allah's commandments and you fulfill what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered you to do, then automatically you'll be eligible for His victory. You will be eligible for His victory. That is the meaning of إِنْ تَنْصُرُ اللَّهَ يَنْصُرْكُمْ وَيَثَبِّتْ أَقْدَامَكُمْ. And that is the meaning of إِحْفَظِ اللَّهَ يَحْفَظُ. So long as you keep your steadfastness on the straight path, especially during times of prosperity, during health, whenever you are in good conditions, then at the time of need, you would always find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala next to you. As in the other narration, إِحْفَظِ اللَّهَ تَجِدْهُ أَمَامَكَ. Be mindful of Allah and safeguard His commandments. You will find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before you. The word before you, يعني always there whenever you need His help. The hadith of the three companions, the three travelers, because that happened in a nation before Islam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said there have been three people from the nations before us. They have been traveling. And at nightfall, they decided to spend the night in a cave. A huge rock slid down and it blocked the entrance of the cave. So it was exceedingly dark inside, extremely dark, they couldn't see. And meanwhile, they realized that no one can take them out of there but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No one could hear them. And this huge rock really blocked the entrance. So each one of them pleaded to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and sought one of the approved means of approach, one of their good deeds, one of their ta'at. And one after another invoked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and sincerely begged Him for His help until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gradually moved the rock a little by little, and finally He moved it completely and they made it out. So there, being mindful of Allah and safeguarding His commandments and trying to do good deeds at the time of prosperity led to finding Allah's help readily whenever they were at the time of adversity. This is a typical example of احفظ الله يحفظك, احفظ الله تجده تجاهك, or in the other narration, احفظ الله تجده أمامك. Safeguard Allah's commandments, you would always find Allah before you, especially at the time of need. What is the meaning of حفظ الله عز وجل للعبد? What does it mean that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will guard you and will protect you? Guard you in your wealth, property, in your health, in your body, in your family, in your children, in your deen, Yes, all of that all together. As far as the deen, which is the greatest protection, of course, this is the thing which the believers are in need for most. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, in ayah number 17 of Surah Muhammad, وَالَّذِينَ اهْتَدَوْا زَادَهُمْ هُدًى وَآتَاهُمْ تَقْوَاهُمْ. As for those who have been rightly guided, Allah increased them in guidance and gave them their righteousness. You just take the initiative. You do a little bit. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will increase your guidance, will increase your piety and your righteousness. So, ihfazillah, be mindful of Allah's ahkam. Allah will protect you. Allah will guide you. Allah will guard you. That's why take this very simple advice from me. At-ta'atu turithu ta'ah. Wal-ma'asiyatu turithu ma'asiyah. What does it mean in English? Doing a good deed would lead actually to doing another good deed. Because when you do a good deed, you draw towards Allah one further step. Accordingly, Allah will encourage you more and He will draw nearer to you. So you will find it easier to do another ta'ah and a third and a fourth and so on and so on and so forth. Versus when the person degrades himself and does a sin, then he neglects it or he does not repent from it. And then he does another one and he keeps lining down, going down the sharp steep, until he degrades himself all the way to the bottom. Why? Al-ma'asiyatu turithu ma'asiyah. So that is the meaning of ihfaz illaha yahfaz. Allah will guard you in your deen, will increase you in your guidance, and keep you steadfast on his straight path, and will guard you in your family, in your wealth. As for instance, we mentioned the story of the three people who got stuck in the cave and how they were saved. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the hadith, in the next segment, إِذَا سَأَلْتَ فَاسْأَلِ اللَّهِ. If you ask, if you seek help, then you should only seek the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you ask for what? I mean, there are multiple questions. Ask السائل وأما السائل فلا تنهر. السائل here, the one who asks, يعني he begs. Surah Al-Duha. He's asking for help. That is as-sa'il. So it could be asking for financial help. Yes. Asking for cure. Asking for guidance. Asking for some connection to get a job, to marry a woman, to get off a hardship. Yes. All of that. If you ask, you should turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with your mas'ala and only ask from Allah. Only ask from Allah. And with regards to asking for the financial help, you find the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says the golden rule of what? It would be better for any of you to take your axe and collect some fire logs and sell it in the market and make a little bit of profit than begging and asking people. Some may give you, some may not. And al-mas'ala comes on the day of judgment as a black marker on your forehead, especially if you ask without need. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, once a man came to him and said, give me some help. So he said, what do you have at home? He said, I have a clock which sometimes I wear, sometimes I use it as a spread, I sleep on top, and I cover myself with half of it, and I have a water container at home. He said, bring it to me. Very insignificant position, nothing. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam took them to the market. He said, who would like to buy these two items? Somebody bought them for 2 dirhams. Okay? So he said, this is 1 dirham. You go and you buy food for your wife and you take it home. And the other dirham, I want you to buy an axe and come back to me. So he did. When he came, he said, take this axe. I don't want to see your face for 15 days. Go to the forest and collect some fire logs and sell them. And after a couple of weeks, come back to me. So after a couple of weeks, the man came and he's dressed up nicely and he looks fresh, like he has eaten a lot and with some money. He said, Ya Rasulullah, I bought a lot of food for my family and I have this cash as well. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, isn't this better than asking that some people may give you and some people may not give you? Al-mas'ala asking and begging comes on the Day of Judgment like a black spot on the forehead of the person who used to ask. Today I just read in the news about a very strange incident. A man who traveled to Saudi to work as a carpenter. And he was not doing very well as far as, you know, income. So he was in need. He begged some people, so he gave him help. And he found out that actually begging is much more profitable than working for a classical job. So what he did, he took begging as a profession. After so many years, he was not even going home. He was not doing anything besides begging. He has made plenty of wealth and fortune. So he returned home and he bought his wife a brand new Land Cruiser. And he is purchasing a hotel to open his own company and travel agency and so on. But this is all haram. Don't think this is prosperity. This is all haram. The person may only ask whenever he is desperately in need. And first of all, ask from Allah, because Allah is the one who softens the heart of those who will give you. And ask whenever you are in serious need. Not just to because you are lazy and you think that people have plenty of mind, it won't hurt you to give you a little bit from here and a little bit from there. So whenever you ask, you should only ask from Allah. Whenever you seek help, you should seek help of Allah. That also have another explanation, which we see wide open in many countries. In many countries that I travel, you see people who have certain places that they go to where there is somebody who's been buried in this place, a pier or a maqam, whether by itself or even beneath a masjid or in the territory of a masjid or a mosque. So if they are in a dilemma or they are in adversity, they go to this place and they communicate with this dead person seeking help from him. Then obviously people try to explain to them as we do all the time, and they use the same invalid excuse which the disbelievers before Islam used to use. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about them in the beginning of Surah Az-Zumar, they said, مَا نَعْبُدُهُمْ إِلَّا لِيُقَرِّبُونَ إِلَى اللَّهِ زُلْفَى. They're confused. They said, we're not really worshipping them, rather we're taking them as means of approach to take our mas'ala to Allah, to bring our demands to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number one, you need to attend this chapter from the beginning, watchfulness. Allah says, وَهُوَ مَعَكُمْ أَيْنَمَا كُنْتُمْ. Allah says, وَنَحْنُ أَقْرَبُ إِلَيْهِ مِنْ حَبِلِ الْوَرِيدِ. And Allah is closer to any of us than his own jugular vein. Allah says, وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ. If my servants ask you about me, I am indeed very near. And many ayat and ahadith in this regard. Why in the world would you go to a human being, whether alive or even dead? And dead is even much more unbelievable. Because the dead person, as believers, we believe that those who are dead are in need for the dua of the living, not the other way around. So why would you go to somebody who is dead and ask him to raise your mas'ala and present it before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? It is out of logic, it is out of reasoning, it is out of deen, and that is considered definitely a typical act of shirk or setting partners to Allah in worship. If you do not believe me, again, listen to this hadith. إِذَا اسْتَعَنْتَ فَاسْتَعِمْ بِاللَّهِ. Whenever you seek help, you should only seek the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you have to understand that no matter what people to do, even if the whole mankind gather together, either to benefit you or to harm you, they can never touch you, neither with a benefit nor with a harm, except with something which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has already preordained for you. That will inherit you what? That will benefit you what? Tranquility. Peace of mind. I'm not going to die before my term. No one is going to take a bite from me. No one is going to take my provision away from me. Only whatever happens to me is by the leave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why the believers should be the most powerful people on earth. They fear none but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are not in need for any but for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They do not ask from any but from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They do not seek the help or seek refuge from any, but from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِن تَصْبِرُوا وَتَتَّقُوا لَا يَضُرُّكُمْ كَيْدُهُمْ شَيْئًا إِنَّ اللَّهَ بِمَا يَعْمَلُونَ مُحِيطٌ. And last but not the least, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, رُفِعَتِ الْأَقْلَامِ وَجَفَّتِ الصُّحُفِ. What has been preordained has been already recorded and no one is going to change it. So calm down and settle, put your trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, have tawakkul and yaqeen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us this certainty and make us put our trust truly in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. رسول الله حبيب الله رسول الله حبيب الله. And only glory to Him. He bore me humans to be the best and give His best religion to them. Allah our God is the greatest. The one and only glory to Him. He bore me humans to be the best and give His best religion to them. So why did they ignore that? Forgetting all about it in paradise. Worshipping cows, fire and stones, selling the best with the cheapest price. So why did they ignore that? Forgetting all about hell and paradise. Worshipping cows, fire and stones.